الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأصلي وأسلم على من بعث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're in our kitab al-Waraqat للإمام أبي معالي للإمام أبي معالي الجويني رحمه الله. We reached أقسام الحكم التكليفي. We were specifically in al-Makruh. That's where we're going to start from today. We finished al-Mahdhur. We're going to now go to al-Makruh. Makruh is ما يثاب على تركه. The person is rewarded by leaving it. Imtithalan. If he does it by way of wanting reward from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. وَلَا يُعَاقَبُ عَلَى فِعْلِهِ. And he is not punished. Huh? وَلَا يُعَاقَبُ عَلَى فِعْلِهِ. And doing it, he is not punished. So this is the fifth and the last one of Ahkam al-Taklifi. Al-Makruh. Makruh is the fifth type of Ahkam al-Taklifiya. And Makruh, in Arabic language, is a ism maf'ul, is a ism maf'ul, mushtaqun min al-karaha, and it's rooted and stemmed from the word al-karaha, disliked. وهي البغض. It is when something is not liked, it's hated. فالمكروه بمعنى المبغض بوزن الاسم المفعول. Technically, what does it mean? ما طلب الشرع. It is what the Sharia requests. تركه, it's leaving. طالبا غير جازم. It is what the Sharia requests for you to leave in a recommended manner. In a recommended manner or not in a forceful manner. So that is the best definition. And we mentioned this before, that the definition that the author of this book he's taking is not the ta'rif that was befitting, meaning he's not taking the ta'rif which is bayan al-haqiqati al-mahiyya, but he's doing ta'rifu bil-rasm. So when we say ma talab al-shar'u tarkuh, what the sharia requests for you to leave, what leaves that part? The previous three. What are the previous three? Wajib and mandub and mubah are leaving that part of the definition. They drop out. ما طالب الشرع تركه. Then when you say غير جازم, what also leaves with the second qaid, the mahdhur, it also leaves. Makruh is what? Makruh is the person is rewarded. والمكروه يثاب تاركه, the person who leaves it imtithalan. Leaves it for the sake of Allah, he gets rewarded, inshallah ta'ala. وَلَا يُعَاقَبُ فَاعِلُهُ. And the one who does it, he's not punished. Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan, in the sharh of this kitab, he says, وَعَلَمْ نَوْ أَنَّ لِلْمَكْرُوهِ ثَلَاثَ اصْطِلَاحَاتٍ عِنْدَ الْعُلَمَاء. The makruh has three definitions. The makruh has three definitions. The first one is مَا نُهِيَ عَنْهُ نَهِيَ تَنْزِيهِ. The first one is that which is prohibited. But the prohibition is not forcefully. And that is the definition that we just took previously. That's the first one. That is the one that we took. لِأَنَّ الْأَحْكَامِ أَرْبَعَةٌ. Because the ahkam is four types. وَكُلُّ وَاحِدٍ قَدْ خُسَّ بِاسْمٍ غَلَبَ عَلَيْهِ. And each and every one of those ones was defined, but that which overtook it. فَيَنْبَغِي. It is then required. أَنَّ الْمَكْرُوهَ إِذَا أُطْلِقَ يَنْصَرِفُ إِلَى مُسَمَّى دُونَ غَيْرِهِ مِمَّا قَدْ يُسْتَعْمَلُ فِيهِ. The second one is haram. Sometimes makruh is used as haram. وَهُوَ. And to use the makruh as haram is غَالِبُ إِطْلَاقَاتِ الْمُتَقَدِّمِينَ. The previous scholars, the majority of their wording was this type, which is that they would use the word makruh as haram. كإمام أحمد بن حنبل والشافعي, such as Imam Ahmad and Shafi'i. They would use the word makruh, and what they meant was haram. فإنهم they يعبرون عن الحرام, they would use haram بلفظ الكراهية, أما بلفظ الكراهة, they would mean haram, but they would use it in the word of كراهة. So they would say كراهة instead of saying haram. Why would they do that? تورعا وحذرا من الوقوع في النهي عن القول. They would do it because they were abstaining, and they were treading on the safer path in not saying that this matter is halal or haram like that. They didn't want to say هذا حلال وهذا حرام, because they were scared of the speech of Allah in Surah An-Nahl, ayah 116. Allah says, ولا تقولوا, do not say, لما تصف ألسنتكم. The ما هي is مصدرية. So when we read it, how do we say it? ولا تقولوا لما تصف, أي لوصف ألسنتكم, because the ما necessitates مصدرية. ولا تقولوا, do not say, لما تصف ألسنتكم الكذب, that which your tongues, your mouths described as a lie. Do not say هذا حلال وهذا حرام. Don't say in a lying way هذا حلال وهذا حرام. لتفتروا على الله الكذب. And then you accuse of Allah, you lie about Allah تبارك وتعالى. لتفتروا على الله الكذب. So Imam Ahmad and Shafi'i before him, they would use the word كراهة, it's disliked. They meant it's haram, but the reason why they said كراهة instead of haram is why? Because of that verse. They were saying out of staying away from being very, saying halal, haram, halal, haram. So they were using a lighter word, which is karaha, disliked. Good. ولكن but, كثيرا من المتأخرين. But what happened is, the majority of the latecomers, the متأخرين, what did they do? غلطوا على أئمتهم. They became incorrect on their own scholars. They became wrong on the scholars. By doing what? ففسروا لفظ الكراهة. And they explained the word كراهة to mean what? في كلامهم, on the speech of their scholars, that it means بكراهة التنزيل. They incorrectly ascribed to their imams that the كراهة that Ahmed and Shafi'i used, the students of or the people who ascribe to the madhab of Imam Ahmed or who ascribe to the madhab of Imam Shafi'i, they incorrectly ascribe to their imams that the karaha here meant what? Karaha to tanzih, which is the first type. When it wasn't meant by karaha to tanzih, it was meant by what? Karaha to tahrim. Karaha to tahrim, haram. They incorrectly did that. وَهَذَا, and that understanding from the latecomers, لم ترد الأئمة, the scholars, the أئمة, that's not what they wanted. ومن كلام إمام أحمد, from the speeches of Imam Ahmad is as follows. Imam Ahmad said, أكره المتعة, I dislike متعة, والصلاة في المقابر, and I dislike this prayer in the graves. The متعة is what? It's two types of متعة, متعة الحج ومتعة النساء. The متعة of حج. And that's sunnah, that's not what he's referring to here. The mut'a that Imam Ahmad is referring to is what? Mut'atun nisa, contract marriage. A man marries a woman with a contract. He'll say, I want to be with you for 2-3 days. While I'm in the city, I want to be with you for 3 days. I'm here only for 3 days. And so he stays with her for how many days? 3 days. On the third day, he's leaving. He's leaving, okay? When he's leaving, he doesn't have to divorce her because it was the contract. So he just has to leave. The 3 days when it happens, automatically they separate. He can't even be with her if he wants to. Even if his journey is 4 days, he can't stay with her. Who practiced mut'a? The Rafidah do now. لذلك, one of the stories that have been narrated is one of these they call themselves Ayatullah. But they are not Ayatullah, they are Ayatullat. He went to Iraq. And when he went to Iraq, because he's the big scholar they love, so he requested for a girl to be given to him. He said, I'm only going to stay here for a couple of days. I want a woman. So they gave him a girl. He slept with her. Huh? And she became pregnant, the woman, the girl. So when she became pregnant, he left. He ordered her, if you become pregnant from this, name the child this. She said, okay. He left. You know, years, 20 years, something went by. Came back to the same city again. And he asked for a woman. So a young girl was brought to him. And he slept with her. And in the morning, they had a conversation and they talked for the couple of days that he was there. And she told him that, my father is one of the Ayatollahs. He told my mother, when she became pregnant, to name me this and that. And then after, they found out it was him. He was sleeping with his own daughter. Islam prohibited mut'a. It prohibited it. And it's qat'i. It's a clear-cut prohibition. Nothing Allah prohibits subhanahu wa ta'ala except there is filth and dirt in it. Nothing good in it. And Ahmad ibn Hanbal is saying, أَكْرَهُ الْمُتْعَةِ. I dislike mut'a. And I also dislike what? وَالصَّلَاةُ فِي الْمَقَابِرِ. Is this karaha, karaha to tanzih or karaha to tahrim? Karaha to tahrim. It's karaha to tahrim. But the madhab, the followers of the madhab, ignorantly, what do they do? They're ignorant, so what do? They say that Imam Ahmad, he saw, it was disliked, mut'a. He would, Imam Ahmad saw, مثلاً, they would say, Imam Ahmad saw that praying in the maqabir, in the graves, it's also. The Prophet ﷺ prohibited praying in the graves, it's haram. Imam Ahmad here is saying it tawarru'an wa hadaran. Okay? And pay attention. This is the same issue that some people made music halal. They said that the scholars used a'imah to salaf, they saw it, they disliked it. It wasn't haram, it's makruh, listening to music. And they brought qawls and speeches of the scholars. Not knowing that the karaha indal mutaqaddimin, itlaqatul mutaqaddimin, the karaha was meant by, the majority of their karaha was meant by tahrim. And both of those two, akrahul mut'at wa salatu fil maqabir, both of them are haram, wa huma muharramani. Mukhtasarul khiraqi, and Imam al-Khiraqi was the 4th century. Mukhtasarul khiraqi. And Mukhtasarul khiraqi is the sharah, it's the book Ibn Qudama explained. Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, the book he explained, the great book, Al-Mughni, which is a kitab, which is a Fiqh al-Muqaran. It's a very big book. Ibn Qudama is explaining Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi. He is explaining that. He was the fourth qarn, fourth century. That's 1,000 years ago. Khiraqi, he said, وَيُكْرَاهُ, and it's disliked. أَن يُتَوَضَّ, that one does wudu. في آنية الذهب والفضة, to do wudu in what? Gold and silver vessel, a utensil which is made out of gold or silver. Is that disliked or is it haram? It's haram. It's haram to do a wudu or even use آنية الذهب والفضة. So مختصر الخراقي, الإمام الخراقي, he's saying ويكره, is disliked. Ibn Qudama, who does the sharh of the kitab مختصر الخراقي, look what he said. He said, أراد بالكراهة. He said, خراقي, he meant by the كراهة التحريم. He meant حرام. ولا أعلم, Ibn Qudama said, I don't know. فيه خلافا. I don't know any خلاف in this issue. Meaning خلاف, anybody who said that you can use vessel, gold or silver as a utensil. I don't know anyone. So the خلاف here, so the كراهة here is what? حرام. وَذَٰلِكَ لِقِيَامِ الدَّلِيلِ عَلَى التَّحْرِيمِ. And the reason he said that is because the haram evidence are clear, they're there. Also Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he said, أَكْرَهُ, Imam al-Shafi'i said, I dislike, أَن يُعَظَّمَ مَخْلُوقٌ, I dislike for a person to be honored, a person to be elevated highly. حَتَّى يُجْعَلَ, until it is made, قَبْرُهُ, his grave, مَسْجِدًا, until his grave is made a what? A masjid. مَخَافَةَ الْفِتْنَة, fear of fitna. عَلَيْهِ, on him. وَعَلَى النَّاسِ, and on the people. The Shafi'iyyah, that innovated in groups of Shafi'iyya madhab who ascribed themselves to the Shafi'i madhab, they took this view and they said Imam al-Shafi'i, he disliked for a masjid to be built on a grave. A masjid to be built on top of a grave. They said Shafi'i, he disliked it. He said karaha. He said وَأَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُعَظَّمَ مَخْلُوقٌ حَتَّى يُجْعَلَ قَبْرُهُ مَسْجِدًا مَخَافَةَ الْفِتْنَةَ مَخَافَةَ الْفِتْنَةُ عَلَى النَّاسِ. But ignorant are they that the karaha here is, it is what? It is haram. Because the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَى اتَّخَذُوا قُبُورَ أَبْيَاهِ مَسَاجِدًا. May Allah's curse be upon the Christians and the Jews. What did they take? They took the grave of who? They took the graves of their righteous people and their prophets' masjids. The Prophet's cursing them, alayhi salatu wasalam. And one of the ways to know that something is haram, rather to know that it's a major sin, is when la'an is connected to it. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah, in his book, The Major Sins, when he mentions how to identify if something is a major sin, one of the ways to know is if la'an is attached to it. And a la'an is what? At-tardu min rahmatillahi, that Allah's mercy is distant from you. So let alone it being haram, it's a kabiratu min al-kabair. It's a major sin. So Shafi'i cannot, huh? Also, Shafi'i is saying makhafat al-fitna, fear of fitna. Can you say fitna is disliked? Fitna is haram. وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصًا. So the fitna is not something that's light. That speech of Imam al-Shafi'i, Abdul Ra'uf al-Munawi, he mentions in his kitab Faidul Qadir. Abdul Ra'uf al-Munawi. We also have to keep in mind that the karaha, also in the Quran Allah used karaha and he meant haram. 25 rulings, pay attention. From the verse, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرًا. From that ayah, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ Surah Al-Isra, Allah mentions 25 ahkam, 25 rulings. Huh? After the 25 rulings, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, what did He say? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, after He says, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, وَكَانَ سَيِّئُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُهًا. كُلُّ ذَلِكَ كَانَ سَيِّئُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُهًا. All of those, it's evil ones that were mentioned, the wrong ones, all of them to Allah are makruh. What was mentioned? Shirk, killing a Muslim, burying your child alive. All of those are mentioned. They are not, zina is mentioned. Can you say that all of those are matters which are disliked? No. So here, even that Allah used, كُلُّ ذَلِكَ كَانَ سَيِّئُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُوهًا مَكْرُوهًا. Even though Allah used it, the karaha is meant by haram. Are you with me? Also Allah said in another ayah, وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعِسْيَانِ. وَكَرَّهَ, Allah used karaha as what? As haram here as well. Because kufr and fusuq and isyan are not matters which are disliked. They are matters which are haram. But also we have to keep in mind, there are some texts that can have the word karaha in it, and it shows dislike. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a man came to him and he said, assalamu alaykum. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, assalamu alaykum. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not upon purity. The Prophet just came out from his call of nature. So what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? The Prophet went, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he done his tayammum. When he finished his tayammum, then he said to the man, wa alaykum as-salam. And then the Prophet said, innahu lam yamna'uni, nothing stopped me. An arudda alayka, for me to reply back to your salam, nothing stopped me. Illa annani karihtu, except that I disliked. An adhkurallaha, except that I disliked to mention Allah. Illa ala tahara, except upon tahara. So the Prophet said, I disliked. Here it doesn't mean haram, it means tanzih, karahatu tanzih. Meaning the Prophet was trying to say, I dislike it. But it's allowed for you, if somebody say, gives you salams, for you, even that you're not upon tahara, you're allowed to say, wa alaykum as-salam. The karaha here is disliked, not haram. Okay, good. Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan mentions a matter which is good, which we need to know, which is, فَإِنْ وَرَدَ لَفْظُ الْكَرَاهَةِ, if the word karaha comes, فِي كَلَامِ الْإِمَامِ أَحْمَدِ, in the speech of Imam Ahmed, مِنْ غَيْرِ, without, أَنْ يَدُلَّ دَلِيلٌ, without any evidence indicating, no evidence indicates, huh? دَلِيلٌ, مِنْ خَارِجِ, there's no external evidence, على إرادة التحريم أو التنزيل, whether it is meant by or is intended as haram or disliked. No evidence is shown here. Hey, the question is that this كراهة, remember now when we showed, when we said that Imam Ahmed said أكره المتعة والصلاة في المقابر, we can prove that he meant here haram because there are external evidences that prove that متعة is haram. Are you with me? يوم خيبر, the Prophet has prohibited متعة. Before that it was allowed. But after خيبر, the Prophet prohibited عليه السلام. So the previous ruling was abrogated. Also, as-salatu fil maqabir, praying in the maqabir, the Prophet has prohibited عليه السلام. Except if a person, janazah, missed him, he can run and pray at in the grave. Other than that, he's not allowed to go and pray in the graves, like salat with a ruku' and a sujood, no. Now pay attention. We've realized Ahmed ibn Hanbal's qawl, akrahu al-mut'ah, was-salatu fil maqabir, that he meant tahrim. We found that because there are evidences that show it's haram. But what about if there is no evidence to show it? Which one of the two does Imam Ahmed mean by it? Is it karahatu tahrimi or karahatu tanzihi? Which of the two does he mean? Some of the groups, they said, yuhmalu ala karahatu tahrim. Some said it means karahatu tahrim. A group have pushed that view. And some have pushed the view that is karahatu at-tanzih. Karahatu tahrim means it's haram. And karahatu at-tanzih is that it is disliked. And the scholars that push the view that is disliked, that the karaha here means disliked, and that it hasn't reached the level of haram, is al-tawfi, al-imam al-tawfi. It is the view of al-tawfi. Also Ibn Najjar, Al-Hanbali, who's known as Al-Imam Al-Futuhi, Sahibu Kitab Sharh Al-Kawkab Al-Munir, one of the best books that are written in Usul Al-Fiqh, Sharh Al-Kawkab Al-Munir. Futuhi said, وَاخْتَارَهُ أَكْثَرُ الْأَصْحَابِ, the majority of majority of the followers of the Madhab of Imam Ahmed. Huh? A lot of the followers of who? Of the Madhab of Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. They were of the view that it meant karahatu tanzi. So Futuhi is trying to say that that's the majority of the view of the Hanbali. All of you pay attention to this. Some people, they make you laugh. Because when they hear, وَقَالَ الْأَصْحَابُ, what do you think? If I say to you, قَالَ الْأَصْحَابُ, who do you understand it as? Who's companions of the Prophet? لا, أصحاب means the companions of the madhab. So here when he says, وَاخْتَارَهُ أَكْثَرُ الْأَصْحَابِ, أي أَصْحَابُ أَحْمَدِ بْنِ حَنْبَلِ, the companions and the people and the followers of that madhab, the a'imma of that madhab. That's what it means. That is the ashab, the companion of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the evidence that Futuhi brought, was the example Usa ibn al-Qayyim brought as well, is Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, أَكْرَهُ النَّفْخَ فِي الطَّعَامِ, I dislike the blowing into the food. وَإِدْمَانُ اللَّحْمِ وَالْخُبْزِ الْكِبَارِ, and consistently eating meat. To eat meat consistently, every time eat meat. والخبز الكبار, and also bread that has been out for long. To also consistently eat that. Ahmed said, I dislike it. Now that cannot be, that's not considered as haram, right? That's not haram. That is considered karahatu tanzi. And it's not considered haram. Because that is when there is no evidence external. The asal of Imam Ahmed's karaha is tanzih. But if there's external evidences, the karaha is then said that it is meant haram. It means haram. That is the first two. The third view. So the first one we mentioned, that the karaha means tanzih. The second one was haram. And now the third one is what? The karaha meaning tarkul awla. Tarkul awla. Tarkul awla means what? Preferably, better than leaving it. It was preferred to leave it. This type, a lot of the usuliyin have forsaken this type. But the fuqaha, they mention it. And this type of karaha, which is called tarkul awla, it falls in between what? It falls between the karaha and the mubah. It's a level in between the karaha and the mubah. It's a wasita, it's a level, it's a stage in between the karaha and the ibaha. And the difference between the makruh and the khilaful awla, or tarkul awla, whichever you call it, it's the same. You can call it khilaful awla or tarkul awla. The difference between that and the makruh is as follows. Pay attention. أن ما ورد فيه النهي. Anything, pay attention, that the prohibition has come regarding it in particular. This is, and it's not in a forceful manner. A prohibition came regarding it, but it's not in a forceful manner. Such as what? Huh? Such as what? Such as turning your neck in the salah. To turn your neck. Are you with me? The person to turn their neck in the salah. Are you allowed to turn right and left? Huh? It's makruh. Al-akhd wal-i'ta' bi-shimal. Taking and giving with what? With the right. With the left. It's also disliked. It's makruh. Are you with me? Okay, Sheikh is going to mention examples, inshallah. The difference between the makruh and the khilaful awla is أَنَّ مَا وَرَدَ فِيهِ النَّهْيُ مَقْصُودٌ. A prohibition came regarding it. Huh? But the prohibition that came regarding it is not in a forceful manner. It is not jazim. غير jazim. Good. That's makruh. As for the khilaful awla, it is what? مَا لَيْسَ فِيهِ نَهْيُ مَقْصُودٌ. There hasn't come a particular prohibition regarding it. But there came a request of an action in a manner. Such as the Sharia requested for you to do an action. Leaving what the Sharia told you to do, but the Sharia didn't request for you to do this action in a forceful manner. So the matter is a sunnah, mathalan. Are you with me? Leaving that sunnah is what? It's khilaful awla. Are you with me? Such as what? Leaving sunnah to dhuhr. Are you with me? The Sharia requested for you to do what? The sunnah of dhuhr. Leaving the sunnah is called khilaful awla. But giving with your left and your right is called makruh. لأن الشريعة came and it showed dislike towards giving your left or your right. In particular, this one. نعم. And Zarkashi عليه رحمة الله, Zarkashi in his kitab البحر المحيط, he mentions that some of the scholars, the speeches that they try to bring regarding تركُ الأولى. He says, والتحقيق, as a summary and a reality, أن خلاف الأولى, the خلاف الأولى is a قسم, it's a type من المكروه, it's a type, part of the makruh. ودرجات المكروه, and the makruh's levels تتفاوت, it differs. It's not one level, the makruh is not one level, it differs, different levels. كما في السنة, as in the sunnah, the sunnah is also levels. ولا ينبغي, and it is not, أن يعد قسما آخرا, and it's not right to consider the khilaful awla a different type. So then what happens? The ahkamu al-takleefi becomes 6 instead of 5. It shouldn't be like that. وَإِلَّا لَكَانَتِ الْأَحْكَامُ سِتَّةٌ وَهُوَ خِلَافُ الْمَعْرُوفِ, and that goes against the what is known. أو كان خِلَافُ الْأَوْلَى خَارِجًا عَنِ الشَّرِيعَةِ. Or some of the people, what did they say? That the khilaful الْأَوْلَى is not part of the ahkamu al-shar'iyya aslan. It has no basis. There's only these five, and it has no base other than that. And that's also not the case. It exists, but it exists under makruh. Now pay attention. Some of you still may have not understood the khilaful awla and the difference between the makruh. The Sharia requested for you to do something. Are you with me? It's a sunnah. Are you with me? That which the Sharia told you to do, that thing which the Sharia requested for you to do, it's a sunnah, such as. praying sunnah to dhuhr. The sunnah of dhuhr. Leaving it is called khilaful awla. Are you with me? Because there's no khilaful awla, there is no prohibition put to it particularly. No, it isn't. It's just the opposite of a sunnah that was mentioned. Whereas the makruh is what? There's a karaha in this particular thing. Like blowing into your food. There's a karaha, this hadith, the Prophet just showed that he disliked it, alayhi salam. Or, for example, giving salams to somebody. Giving salams to somebody whilst you're on a state of this impurity. The Sharia clearly came, and what did it do? This particular thing, it prohibited it in a, not in a forceful manner. In a recommended manner. This is makruh, clearly. Lakin, this one is the opposite of a recommended act. Khilaful awla is called. That is the difference between makruh and khilaful awla. And we'll stop there, inshallah. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.